All right. Today is June 28th, 2021. My name is Sonia He, and today I'm interviewing Mr. Perry Young for the Houston Asian American Archive. Thank you so much for being here today with us, Mr. Young. And I guess my first question is, when and where were you born?
I was born in Oakland, California in 1964.
Okay, and then how would you kind of describe the household you grew up in and your family life as a child?
Well, I think it was a very typical Chinatown, first generation immigrant parent family household, apartment complex. We lived on a second floor and in Chinatown. So I would say that my community was all bilingual, Cantonese from the Khoisan region dialect, and working parents in the traditional Chinese jobs, which is cooks, laundrymen, seamstresses. We went to a school in Chinatown that was 90% Chinese, first and recent immigrants. And all my friends were mostly Chinese Americans until we moved out of Chinatown around the age of when I was around 11 into the Oakland Hills. And so then my friends suddenly became a more sort of like a diverse rainbow coalition of Oakland.
That's nice. So how would you describe the kind of two neighborhoods? You kind of said that Chinatown was mostly Chinese. And then how would you describe the differences or maybe the challenges of living there when you were 11?
Yeah, well, you know, I think of it as a very rare experience for Chinese in America to grow up in an environment that was where you're the majority. So within those like maybe square city blocks, we were mostly the majority. And even in my school, it was, you know, like I said, 90% Chinese Americans. And we saw the Black, Mexican, white kids as the other, as the minority that that we got along with, but we saw them as definitely the minority. And Chinatown we roamed freely throughout Chinatown. Everybody knew each other. This was the 60s and 70s. All the people I saw on the streets were parents of my friends or cousins. My cousins, my friends' cousins, it's like everybody knew each other. It was probably, I would say that the Chinatown denizens at that point maybe were only like 1,000 people at the most, probably not even that much, but we knew most of the people, and every restaurant we went into, every shop we went into, we were very familiar with the owners, and the owners, although they might not know us by name, knew who we were, knew we were the kids that would come every day after school. There were our favorite little, preserved fruit shops, very Chinese snacks. Like, they saw us every day. And it was such a beautiful community. And, I think that it was something that's, I'm lucky to have had growing up, when I hear about other Chinese Americans or immigrants, not immigrants, people of color who couldn't identify with the culture they grew up necessarily, or they stuck out, or they were the other. So I was lucky to have that. And, but I also recognized that Chinatown was very insular in that it was surrounded by more impoverished Black neighborhoods. Like, we were in downtown Oakland. So, there was Broadway, which was the border of Chinatown and West Oakland, which was one of the most impoverished neighborhoods in Oakland, and it was quite dangerous. So when we would wander off into Broadway, because that's where the movies were, and we were kids, we can watch these downtown movies, are known as grindhouse theaters, where you would see, like three movies for a dollar, in the 70s, you would see like horror movies, B movies, and kung fu movies. So we would go to these places and spend a lot of our childhood, summers, many summers were spent there. And we would recognize that, it would be a little dangerous because we were just this, little group of Chinese kids. And we would see, what an urban environment in the downtown Black city was like in the 70s. It was dangerous. But we were able to navigate it, and sometimes we'd get our lunch money taken or something like that. That was where we saw my first Bruce Lee movies, and we saw the culture change right when Bruce Lee's movies were coming out. We really saw how representation can impact the culture positively. and not just our culture, but the larger American culture, because Blacks became a big fans of martial arts and Bruce Lee. And I saw like our world change because suddenly we weren't picked on anymore. We were like the cool kids because we might have known some kung fu, you know? Mm-hmm. So we had that experience of knowing that also things could be dangerous right outside of Chinatown, and that there were inequities, you know, because like there were, when my family moved to the Oakland Hills in a more middle-class neighborhood that was more, you know, mixed in terms of Black, white, Chinese, I saw that we didn't have the same kind of tension on the streets. You know, the streets were cleaner, more spacious, trees, you know, mm-hmm. and you're like, wow, this is a very different neighborhood, a very different way of living. And then I would visit my friends in Chinatown and notice, yeah, this is an impoverished neighborhood. You know, people are stacked up on top of each other. And Chinatown was not as clean as, you know, where we moved. So up in the Oakland Hills, I got to get a taste of the larger American society.
Mm-hmm. What would you say are some of the values your parents emphasized in your upbringing? Do you think this is influenced kind of by the different environments that you grew up in?
Well, my parents were very traditional Chinese, Cantonese, from Guangzhou and Hong Kong. My father's from Toisan, Guangzhou, which is where most Chinese immigrants came from historically. And my mother's from New Territories, Hong Kong. So it was kind of like a country bumpkin meets the city girl, I think. or at least she moved to the city. And I think that maybe her father was a country bumpkin. So I think that there was very traditional Confucianist, patriarchal kind of Buddhist, you know, culture. So the family was very important, and how you committed or aligned yourself with your work and how it pertains to supporting the family was very important. There was always a status that, you know, you always had to honor the elders, respect the elders. And there was a hierarchy, obviously, you know, in learning how your uncles and aunts were named, aunt number one, aunt number two, aunt number three, and then your cousin number one, cousin number two, cousin on your father's side number one. So it was kind of ridiculous, you know, but it was a way that society sort of had to be organized and have a kind of respect, an order of respect. So I didn't really realize all that growing up, obviously, but I did know the numbers, you know, and how to call my aunts and uncles and regard them as the big uncle and that kind of stuff. So I realized there was some hierarchy, but I didn't really learn about it till later on in life. So I would say that I was imparted a lot of those traditional values of respecting your parents, and trying to be sure that you don't embarrass or shame your parents in doing, you know, bad things, because that seemed to be more important, is the shaming, you know, dishonoring your parents. And it's kind of funny when I see that in Mulan or something, you know, don't dishonor your parents. It's like, actually, that's true. You know, that comes from an Asian, at least a Chinese culture that I know of. So I think that was passed on. And, you know, I think that my parents were a little less lenient towards career that some of my friends was more pressured into. Finding a job that was lucrative or well-paying or respectable, more respectable. So whether it's a doctor or a lawyer or engineer and those things, I think that I saw some of my friends pressured into that with schooling. And my parents were more just, I think that they imparted a stronger work ethic towards me and more be happy, earn a good living, and respect people around you and be a good human being, as opposed to get the most out of the dollar. You know, that I think some of the immigrants, my Chinese friends, were exposed to.
Mm-hmm. What were your parents, or like, what were your parents' careers when you were younger?
My parents were very, they had the very typical quintessential Chinese American jobs. When they came, my father was a laundryman, a chef. My mother was a seamstress, a babysitter. And then she worked in a factory, paper factory, where she was basically, you know, boxing paper that was being cut in the sort of like a mill. And my father continued to drive out, you know, still be involved with laundry, but work outside of the actual laundry by driving a delivery truck. So he would drive all over Oakland, picking up big orders from, you know, hotels and things like that, so that his laundry can do all, you know, like commercial laundry. And then when we were teenagers, my father bought the quintessential Chinese restaurant in the middle of nowhere, and that was Texarkana, Texas. So we became that Chinese family in the middle of nowhere.
Mm-hmm. And I guess what were some of the things that interested you as a kid? You mentioned you went to the movie theaters a lot, and did that kind of influence what you wanted to do in the future?
I think so. I mean, I was the youngest of three boys, so... And my parents were immigrants, and I think that they were preoccupied with making a living, like most immigrants. And all I can remember was I was babysat by the television a lot. I think I was left alone a lot. And when I wasn't alone, I was tagging along with my older brothers and basically just thinking, oh yeah, I think my older brother just has to take care of me, you know, because there's no one else around. So I was heavily influenced by television. And at a certain age, when I was able to really be by myself and other kids, I think we were probably around maybe 10 or 11 when we were able to wander through the streets of Oakland by ourselves and go to these theaters. So it was a lot of film. I think of a lot of TV, television, and film was the major form that influenced me growing up. And there was music also. I think my father liked to blast Cantonese opera in the house, you know, but he was also very quick to assimilate. So I remember also Elvis Presley being played loudly, you know, on our like hi-fi stereo set that he'd buy. So my father was definitely into pop culture and assimilating, and he would dress more Western quickly as I look back at photos. So I would say that mostly it was film, television, and popular music, actually.
Did your parents really kind of try to bring you up with the traditional Chinese culture besides the Confucian values, or did they try to encourage you to assimilate?
I think that by osmosis, they encouraged us to just be good people and work hard. Like, I don't think that they knew what assimilation really meant, you know, like, I think that because their community was definitely in Chinatown, and they didn't really think about moving out until we moved to Texas. I think they just thought about trying to, I think, you know, at their level, I think being in America and working hard and being able to buy a car and have a decent apartment that can house three kids was already a luxury that they never had. So I don't know if they never imparted any sort of philosophy or encouragement to get more out of us. Like, they never said, you have to get better than this. So we went to Chinese school. So after the English school, and I'm not sure if they actually wanted us to learn Chinese or it was just more babysitting, you know, like for immigrant parents, that's like, oh yes, this will keep the kids busier for the next, you know, 3 hours after school until we get off work. And so it's good that they should, you know, maybe if they learn to read a few Chinese characters, it's a good thing. So I just remember going to Chinese school and it being very strict. The teachers were very strict. You know, it was not as fun as Western white American, you know, education. So I think that part of I've never asked them, but, you know, it was either that they wanted us to continue to learn a little bit about, you know, Chinese culture and reading and stories through that education, or it was just more babysitting.
When did your family move to the United States, and did your parents ever tell you why they decided to move?
Well, I was born in 1964, so and they had been here a year. They had immigrated the year before, and that was basically when the most of the quotas from the Chinese Exclusion Act was finally lifted in 1963. So they were really able to immigrate then. But my great grandfather was the first, as far as I know, to immigrate from Toisan. So I know that around the turn of the century, my great grandfather came and most likely worked on the railroads and then made his way to Chicago at the end of the railroads and opened up a laundry. So we're like, I'm like generations of very typical Chinese American labor. Because my great grandfather sent money back to China, his son was able to go to school and become a Chinese medical doctor. And so he didn't have to immigrate or feel the need to immigrate. But by the time my father was born, the story is that they were escaping communism by leaving China. So like many Chinese friends that I had growing up in Chinatown, all our stories are very similar. Like everybody can say that their parents or their uncles and everyone swam across the Delta in, you know, from China to Hong Kong, and then made their way to America. And that's sort of like, it was like everybody's story, you know, it wasn't just mine. So it was really interesting how we all had a shared history. So it was never really told to me because, you know, my father died when I was 15, but my mother would tell me that story. It's like, oh, your father and his uncle and your uncle swam across the river, you know, to Hong Kong and to escape communism. And so I felt like maybe my grandfather, you know, he also escaped communism by going to Hong Kong, but he didn't feel the need to go further to America. So I have a feeling, just like everybody else, you know, the reputation of America at the time was so strong as Gold Mountain, and that's mm-hmm. the place to make it. So just following in the footsteps of his grandfather, I'm sure that's probably why he immigrated.
Okay, yeah. And did your parents ever talk to you about the difficulties of immigrating, like any culture shocks, or how just 1 year after the Chinese Exclusion Act was lifted, like were there any like difficulties adjusting to the new legislation and all that?
Yeah, my parents are, you know, both, I probably did not finish, you know, junior high school at that level. So they're uneducated, you know, kind of peasant labor force people, like most people from Southern China. So I have a feeling they didn't really understand the laws at all of what was happening in America. They probably realized, hey, we can actually immigrate right now. They're allowing people in. So, and my parents being very typical of, especially my father, of a lot of Chinese American fathers, is they don't talk, you know, mm-hmm. They're just there as a patriarchal figure to, you know, I think he showed a lot of love and care in terms of raising and nurturing, but there wasn't a lot of dissemination of information. And I don't think that was, you know, in his culture, or at least his level of his class of people, he was not of the educated class. So he didn't talk a lot about philosophy or art or politics, you know. It was more like, you know, playing mahjong, you know, and you know, maybe trying to understand what America was like and fit in. And my mother also had a very similar situation where she had to drop out of school to work for the family, I think. So they didn't have a lot of that kind of information to pass on. And I basically had to go to college to learn about the history of Chinese in America. When I would ask my mother about it as I got older and more curious about 16, 17, and this was after my father had passed away, my mother would say, oh, it was just so hard. I don't think you want to know about that. It was difficult. You know, we were so poor. And you know, and then she would give me, every time I would ask, I was like, oh, you don't want to know about that. But, you know, your grandfather on her side, you know, her mother, her father was a carpenter, you know, and it was like, he wouldn't always have work to do. So sometimes he didn't even have materials, but when people would hire him to build a house, he would have to like fashion bricks out of mud, you know, and carry the mud, you know, the bricks hand by hand. So she would tell these stories and I'm like, wow, there's so many stories in there, but she wouldn't tell it all at once. It was just like, oh, I'll give you a little bit now, you know, because it's just like scaffolding the information because it might be too intense for this 17-year-old kid or 16-year-old kid asking me this stuff, you know? Mm-hmm. And it's, you know, I would hear little bits like, oh yeah, and when I was a kid, you know, we would have to run and hide because people would say, the Japanese are coming, you know, run, hide, you know? And so I'm like, oh, wow, this was World War II, you know, and the Japanese were invading, you know. And so there were a lot of stories that they didn't feel like we had to know. And, you know, it's unfortunate because those are some seriously authentic stories that define who we are. And actually, it's probably why I'm kind of inquisitive now in the history of my family and Chinese Americans.
Yeah, there's definitely a lot of like trauma and just hardship that a lot of immigrants just don't like to impart on their children, just kind of live a new life, I think.
Definitely, definitely. They just want to move on. I mean, so many immigrants just want to move on.
Yeah, so could you tell me a little bit about your education? Like where do you went to maybe elementary school, middle school, high school, college, and what did you enjoy in school?
Well, I went to Lincoln Elementary School in Oakland, California. Again, like I say, it's predominantly, you know, Chinese Americans of the first and second generation, or maybe and immigrants. A lot of people were just like me, bilingual, speaking English and Cantonese. And it was fun, you know, it was really fun. I had a great fun childhood there. We did everything that I think, you know, if you read about white American middle-class schools, they did, we had plays, dances, went on field trips to, you know, science centers, planetariums. We did all of that. You know, and it was not only until recently that a friend of mine told me that Lincoln School, Lincoln Elementary in Oakland is one of the specialized schools in Oakland where it's like, you know, a higher learning, you know, so it's interesting. And then we went to, when my family moved out of Chinatown into the more, right at the base of the hills, we went to a middle-class neighborhood that had quite a mixed group of student body. It was, I think it was predominantly Black, but a lot of white, Mexican, and other Asian, you know, diaspora, you know, Japanese, Cambodian, and yeah. And it was then suddenly a kind of a wild awakening of like, oh my God, this is a real Oakland, you know, like we were just in our little enclave for so many years. And I knew that another Oakland existed, but there was no other reason to really go that far out and you know, like live in, you know, I would touch other neighborhoods and just see it, but to actually live in the whole other neighborhood and to make friends. I quickly made friends with a lot of non-Chinese, you know, because, you know, I went from a school of 90% to maybe a school of 10-15% Chinese and Asians. And so it was like, oh, wow, this is very different. but it was also, there was an opportunity for me to diversify my friends and hanging out after school in my immediate neighborhood where were Blacks and, like, you know, Mexicans that rode their bikes around, and I joined them quickly with my bike and became really good friends with the people who were not Chinese. And that was new to like relate and hang out to people who didn't speak Cantonese and have the same shared history. It was exciting. It was a great time. It was kind of a flourishing of identity for a, you know, 12 or 13 year old. And then my parents moved to Texas. So, and I spent that first day in my new junior high in Texarkana, Texas, was a quite another kind of awakening as I walked into the school and realized, like, I'm the only Chinese, I'm the only Asian in this whole school. And, you know, walking, you know, I was walking down the hallway from the office of getting checked in to go into my first class. I mean, the hallway sort of parted like as if I was Moses and that was the Great Sea, you know? I mean, it was just like people parted ways for this like alien. They've never seen a Chinese person before. This was 1979. Right, and Texarkana, Texas. What I heard and saw was there was the next day there was one other Asian. He was Vietnamese. So after, you know, they relocated from after the war to more down towards Galveston, Texas, and probably his family made his way up to Texarkana. But I just saw him one day, and then I heard there was another one, and then he was gone. Like his family moved. But so it was weird because after the first day. Or two, I realized that their education level was really below that of Californians. Like kids in my grade level couldn't really read well at all. And when the teachers asked me to read a paragraph from a history book, and I realized, man, these kids are listening to me speak English and read better than them. And it's so odd because I have this yellow face, you know, that's so alien to them. So that further alienated me from making friends, you know. So that was my first, you know, week in junior high in Texas. But I quickly fell in with, you know, this was late 70s, early 80s. And there was really only three or four kinds of people in Texas. You know, there were like, you know, there were like the Aggies, you know, the families of farmers. I don't have to explain to you. then there were I forgot what we call them, the jocks, you know, and then the nerds, you know, and then the freaks, the ones that get high, you know. And I didn't fit into any of them well, but the freaks were the most open to accept me, you know, because they just also didn't fit in, you know, to the nerds or the jocks or the Aggies. So I became friends with a lot of, I became a freak. I had long hair, smoked pot and all that stuff, and went to rock concerts and got into, that's where I actually learned how to play guitar and realized, developed a love for rock and roll. Because I think, you know, like I said earlier, I did enjoy music a lot, but I didn't start playing. Oh, actually I did. I played the trumpet in elementary school, you know, in Chinatown, and I got pretty good at it, but I never pursued it more formally, you know, formal lessons. So when I got into Texas and picked up the guitar and it fit in with the culture, I just really gravitated towards, you know, rock and roll and that sort of culture. Music, playing in a band. And then I guess after, then I worked at the restaurant after school. But then my dad contracted cancer and it got bad. We sold the restaurant, moved back to the Bay Area. And I went to high school in Oakland, and I realized that was another culture shock now. So because that high school was, had a lot of Asian American, you know, had Chinese, white. It was more up in the hills now. It's a little more affluent area of Oakland, mm-hmm. called Skyline, the high school. And in Texas, I developed a sort of like a rock star persona because I went and looked at me. You know, it wasn't racist, but it was a curiosity. Who's this kid? He's Asian and he speaks English, you know, everywhere I went. But when I went back to Oakland, it was like I was anonymous, invisible. And I was like, I started to get another kind of, you know, like, wait, I'm here. Hello, you know, now I'm invisible. And it's another culture shock. So that was kind of odd in finishing high school that way. And I came back with a Southern drawl. So I spoke with a little Texarkana accent, and everywhere I went, I said, hey, how you doing? You know, what y'all finna do? And it was just really like, people were like, what are you? You know, so I didn't fit in back in Oakland until a friend finally said, you know, you got the Southern accent, that's really weird, you know? And I went, oh yeah, I better get rid of that. You know, so I worked for a year or two to get rid of it. So that was my high school. And then by that time, my mother was a single mother, my dad had passed away, and my two older brothers were all out on their own doing stuff, you know, in Oakland. And, you know, I realized that, wow, you know, like, I realized that difficult, this is when I started to see my mother as an individual and not the caring person, you know, the nurturing person your mother is until you're as the kid. And I started to wonder about, you know, like, all the laws and culture and the things that affected her, right? Because she was isolated in Chinatown. She never had to learn English because of her community. And when she moved to Texas, she basically worked again, isolated in the Chinese restaurant, never had to learn English. And coming back and, you know, thinking about the opportunities that were available to her as an immigrant who didn't speak English, we're still gonna be relegated to Chinatown. I just have to look at this message because it looks like it's from my family. That's it's okay.
All right, yeah, take your time.
So that's when I really started to go, you know, I don't really know much about American history, you know, especially having just come from Texas, which I feel like the education and history was, you know, was very limited, limiting. And even in California, it was a little better. You know, in California, I think I at least heard about the Japanese relocation camps during World War II in high school. And that was another thing. It's like, wait, that's all I get? You know, is this one little chapter or mention? It wasn't even a chapter, it was a mention about Japanese American relocation camps and what happened during World War II. And there was no like, what, but why? You know, there was none of that. It was just the information. So as I started to ask these questions, it was like, you know, like, what is my future here? You know, and again, my parents didn't push me like some other Asian Americans, you know, like we are definitely not the model minority, you know, in my family, you know. So I took it upon myself to just to live a little bit of life, you know, like I got into music and played in bands and got into art in my own way until I finally realized I couldn't do it with a limited education. And then thanks to my middle brother, Paul, who was a high school dropout in Texas, you know, at that age, he was approaching being a senior and he just dropped out, you know, I totally understand why. But when he came back, also he realized he's got to get educated. So he took a GED, went to junior college, got a bachelor's from UC Berkeley, and then went and got a master's from UCLA. But while he was doing that, he was basically, you know, trying to tell me that I should go to school, and it worked. You know, so I went to school, SF State, and my first day in the Asian American history class, it was like, that's the moment I became woke. You know, that's when you start learning about laws that oppress people of color. And I'm not talking, this is not critical race theory we're talking about. These are just facts and history that's being taught. You know, and I started to get so interested in Asian American history because like, where was I all this time? Where was this information? And I started to minor in Asian American history, but at the same time I was doing an art degree because I thought that's what I really am passionate about is art. And music, you know, I really wanted to play rock and roll, but rock and roll was something that you don't study in college, you know, it's just a lifestyle. Mm-hmm. But art was something that you had to study, I think at the time at least. So, and thanks, you know, I recommend to everybody to go to college unless you know what you're doing, unless you have a better choice, you know, because college would basically expose you to all of the other pathways that you would normally never be exposed to. And then you can decide what you want to do. And in that, but all the different exposures, I learned about dance, modern dance and theater, and which brought me to my career today, which is still very interdisciplinary in terms of music, theater, acting, and activism.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. I'm wondering, were your parents and your siblings supportive of your decision to pursue art? You kind of mentioned that they were kind of hands off in terms of what you wanted to do, but I know.
Yeah. My mother, you know, she was very supportive. I mean, she was just the best mother ever in terms of, are you happy? Are you working hard? You know, well, here, eat up, you know? So, you know, like she was so nurturing. She was just the best Chinese mother. I mean, you know, the best mother. Best uneducated mother because she wasn't able to share guidance in terms of like what are you studying, you know, and what's your GPA and what are you gonna do, you know, are you gonna go on to study to get a terminal degree or you know, like there was none of that in her world at all, right? She knew how to be a really good mother in terms of cooking and taking care of, and so I value that and the love that she imparted. So she was so encouraging, and I would say it's the foundation of everything I do is that kind of love, you know, because it's empathy, it's compassion that you have for other people that you share with others. So regardless of whether it's something that helps in a career or not, it informs all aspects of one's life is, you know, the parenting, right? The support and parenting that you get, that comes from love, simply just love and nurturing. But as I mentioned from my middle brother, Paul, I got a lot of encouragement from him in terms of like, you know, you should study art. You should study the philosophy of art. You know, when you go to an art gallery, what are these people talking about? Can you talk at their level? Can you talk about art history? Can you talk about philosophy? Can you talk about forms, you know, and all of the stuff in theory? And it was like, oh yeah, I know nothing about that. You know, I knew how to draw and paint what I like, but I don't know, I didn't know where it came from, how I was influenced, the systems I wanted to be involved with, where I was gonna take it. So it was like, yeah, I need to be educated, you know? And if you don't find a mentor, you know, I think once you go to school for it. So I had a lot of good direction and encouragement from my brother, middle brother, Paul. From my older brother, you know, Peter, also a lot of love, a lot of, you know, big brother energy, you know, what do you need, you know? I'm gonna get it for you. What do you need? You know, it's like, it's all great, you know. But he didn't go to college. He graduated from high school and he went into the civil service. Like, he became a firefighter. Mm-hmm. So he became a firefighter. Yeah, it was his life's career until he retired. And a lot of good energy from him in terms of, you know, being that traditional big brother that I think, you know, that Confucianism taught him to take care of your younger brothers, you know. So I got that from him, you know, and a lot of love also. So from the family, I would say that I was extremely lucky just to have gotten that fundamental support of familial love.
Yeah, that's really important, especially for, I feel like, anybody pursuing like a career in art. It's so difficult, I feel.
Completely. Nobody supports it. unless your parents are artists, I think, mm-hmm. then they understand that. Like, for example, I have a teenager now who's also an artist, just graduated from high school this year, going to an art school. And I actually was trying to talk him out of it. You know, how I was like, are you sure you want to, you know, do art? Because it's not going to be a place where you're ever going to feel financial support, really. You know, I, most of society will never really understand what you're doing, you know. But I could tell you from my experience, you shouldn't look to, you know, the monetary gains as a way of measuring your success. You know, it's a, you know, as an artist, it's what you're saying, your process, and whether you're helping the world. You know, there are many other philosophies to do art, of course, but if you're going to do it with that way, a lot of the society will not understand you. And so, you know, you're always going to have to defend yourself and what you do. Are you ready for a life of that? But, you know, I realize he's 17 and I did a lot of growing up and learning and changing by the time I was 17 and 18, 19, you know, to when I graduated. And even throughout my career, my philosophy about what I do has changed. So, yeah.
Yeah, definitely. What were some of the challenges you faced in college or in your career with regards to your decision to become an artist?
I think the main challenge was that the education system, the university system, did not prepare me to understand the work that lays before you when you graduate being an artist. I think if you're in business or, you know, engineering and medicine, there are pathways that you continue on. That's pretty clear. It's pretty clear how you can continue on as a doctor or a lawyer and things like that. But as an artist, there is really no pathway to what is, because there's no one goal of what success is. I mean, you could look at many different kinds of artists and what their definition of success is going to be different. And it's not really, some is based on money, is whether they become self-supporting, financially stable, and that's one way of measuring success, but it's not really, it's certainly not the only way, and it shouldn't be the only way that you measure success as an artist. So I felt like those professors in my art department, although they were great artists and great teachers, also didn't understand how to prepare me for all the unknowns that face an artist. And well, they themselves are teachers in the university system now, so that's where they ended up and that's how they make a living. But there are so many other ways. And since I graduated, there are more ways to make a living and be successful, and ways of being an artist with, you know, social media, Instagram, TikTok, and people making money off that. All these young artists are eschewing a formal education in arts because they can make more money being a TikTok artist, whatever that means, you know, and gain more notoriety, reputation, affect more of the culture than ever before through their platform on TikTok and Instagram, more than ever before than a gallery artist in the 80s or 90s showing in galleries and getting their works printed in books. So these young artists have already surpassed that criteria in terms of exposure and notoriety or reputation, and even probably making money. So it's taking apart that older system of the hierarchy of how art is made. So I think the obstacle was basically not enough information. And I don't know if that's something that you can hold one institution responsible for, because I think when you look at society now, there are so many ways to get information, and that we, you know, whether it's from your parents, mentors, a peer group, friends, coworkers, a boss, TikTok, Instagram, social media, there are so many ways to grow and get informed and educated and decide what's good for you in your path. We can't really lay it all on, say, for example, the institution or your parents and blame it on them and say, they didn't teach me properly. It's like, because they're limited, you know, everybody's yeah. limited. Everybody can only share what they think is important at the moment in that particular culture. You know, 5 years down the road, it's going to be different. So some of those who are lucky, and I think I was one of them, where I had my foot in Asian American studies, so I understood history and activism. And then I had my foot in the fine arts, which really understood a more abstract language and understanding of the world, and music, which is also abstract. And then theater, you know, which is a very community-based. So I had my foot in a lot of different forms, and then those things informed me of my world, which, you know, is a conglomeration of all these different forms that are usually very disparate for other people. And that allowed me to sort of look and question which system did I want to engage in and become successful in. And then that allowed me to also question what is success, if it's only success in one system, but it's eschewed from another system, you know. So it's really like just I think education, the obstacle towards education, is all around us, and that we should I guess it's just very limited, and it's like, how does one know that they should look all over the place and take information from everywhere as part of education, and not just from your parents and the university system?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. With the advancements of like the internet and technology, there's a lot more information available to everybody who wants to pursue something different from like the mainstream, I guess.
How you choose to live your life, you know, all those models, like, you know, how do you choose, who you choose to love, how you choose to live your life, what is success, where do you live your life, and what kind of home, two-car garage, that, you know, that two-car garage, white picket fence is so far removed now from what is reality or the goal for Americans. You know, the American dream, I think, is something else now.
Yeah, definitely. I'm curious, what is your definition of success? Since you brought it up a couple times, what do you consider to be successful? And if it's like towards a certain career or like the involvement of different systems you mentioned?
I think my my idea of success is being free from pressures of conforming to job or practice that you personally have never questioned. So success is when you're able to understand enough about philosophy and life and be able to survive at some level of comfort that does not hurt anyone, that does not enslave or oppress another. So I think, I think that kind of success is an everyday question.
Mm-hmm. That makes a lot of sense. It's very insightful.
Well, I hope it does, you know, you know, because I question that a lot, because it's like, well, you know, when my kids get out of the home, I mean, they're on their own. You know, I hope that I gave them enough tools to understand how to be happy. I mean, I'll always be their father, and I'll always impress, give them shared philosophy when they ask. But I don't feel like I'm the person that needs to go into a 30-year, you know, loan to own a house so that they can always come home, so that I'm enslaved to that kind of, you know, until I'm 85 or whatever. So it's like, that's not success to me. So it's like, that could be really weird to someone else who has sort of taken that and been indoctrinated into the American dream. You know, it's like, wait, you don't want to provide a home for your family? It's like, well, you know, I do, but home is not a place where I'm, you know, took out a 30-year loan, you know. Mm-hmm. Home is something else.
Yeah, definitely. So I kind of want to touch on your like different careers or different involvements in the community, and kind of starting with acting. Pursuing an acting career is like very difficult from what I understand. And I feel like, especially for an Asian American, even one who grew up in the United States, can you kind of describe how you started and like how you got your next role every time and how would you, like, would you ascribe your success to luck or mentorship, or like kind of how did you become such a successful actor?
I could write a book. Actually, I'm going to write a book about all of that. So I'll try to fit it into something succinct. As I just said, I was studying visual arts, but while in school at San Francisco State, I saw a play by Philip Khan Gotanda called Yankee Dog, You Die. And it was about Asian stereotypes in Hollywood. And you know, I was sitting in the theater, and it was an Asian American repertoire theater company in San Francisco, 1986 or 1987, and Saab Shimono was one of the actors, and Kelvin Han Yi was one of the actors. I remember sitting in the audience going, that looks pretty cool what these guys are doing. You know, I'm just in a studio with paint on a canvas, and you know, I'm discovering what it's like to dance. Actually, I'm taking dance classes so being social is actually quite cool, working on a dance with other people and collaborating and feeling the energy, you know, being on the same boat with people, you know, it's actually quite cool. And then when I saw that play, I went, I want to do what they're doing, because they're telling a story about Chinese Americans and Asian Americans that's important, you know, and they're affecting me in this audience. They're talking to me, you know, will my paintings ever do that? Will I do the kind of paintings that's going to show in a gallery or theater that's going to reach people and say, see, this is cool, right? What I'm doing is cool. I said, I don't know if paintings are going to do that for me, you know? So I went, that was one of those light bulb moments and one of those, you know, woke moments. And about the same time, I saw a play by one of my mentors, Fred Ho, jazz musician who was an activist and who did activism through his music. And he had a band called the Afro-Asian Art Ensemble, and it was about uniting Blacks and Asians. This was the 80s, right? Way before his time, you know. Fred unfortunately passed away of cancer about 10 years ago. But, you know, these days I've been asking, where is Fred? We need someone like Fred now, you know, because he was with this Black Asian solidarity, you know, the time when the Grace Lee Boggs and Yuri Kochiyama was also, you know, he was up that generation or shortly after. And it was like, man, these people were doing it before, you know, before now. And we need them as our ancestors whose shoulders we stand on. So I saw Fred Ho's Not a Chinaman's Chance about the building of the railroads. And then the musicians were Black and Chinese playing jazz instruments, you know, saxophones and clarinets with the Chinese erhu, you know, and the guzheng, you know, China. And I was like, man, that is so cool, right? Performing, putting your body in front of people, representing with your body. That's what I want to do. So that was around 86 or 87. And seeing Fred, you know, the Asian American Theater Company, and then Jenny Lim, a poet in San Francisco, also talking, you know, using her poetry and then seeing Wayne Wang's early films that were just coming out, Chan is Missing, and one of the films, Dim Sum, was starring my teacher at SF State, Lorraine Chu. She was an actress in Dim Sum, and then she was a teacher in our Chinese American Communities class. And she was so cool, right? And she was also an activist. And she was like, you know, we got a story to tell and we have to be vocal about this, right? And about that time, I started to see like what the Chinese students had done, or not just Chinese, but the Chinese African Black students and the third world, I think it was called third world liberation students did to demonstrate and fight and picket to make the ethnic studies department at SF State in the late 60s. So they picketed for months, they got beat up by cops, they struck, and finally the Asian American Studies major was, you know, an ethnic studies department was declared. And so I learned about all the struggles of people of color and the solidarity that was necessary to make things happen, you know, because we can't do this alone, right? We need all of us in agreement with a shared goal. And that goal is to get educated, you know, to get proper education. And if we're paying the universities for it, then you guys have to give us teachers who can actually teach us, give us this, impart this education. So I think I was, you know, lucky that I chose SF State instead of art school, because I had a chance to go to art school. And that's why I was like discouraging my son to go to art school. It's like, well, you're gonna be limited in the kind of classes you can take. I wandered off into Asian American studies, changed my world, you know? But I think that he's actually in a place where he can actually take school classes from another college that's like a sister college. Mm-hmm. So, and I'm gonna strongly encourage him to take classes outside of his discipline. And again, it goes back to being around the right people, around the right vocal people. And so that kind of fire from activism and understanding that my history comes from being oppressed, and the fact that my mother never was forced to learn English, not forced, but had the opportunity to learn English, was because she was forced into Chinatown. And we were all forced to live in Chinatown. And hey, it's comfortable in Chinatown. You don't have to leave. Just keep speaking Chinese. And then your jobs will be limited and your economic growth would be limited, and you'll be stuck next to a very impoverished Black community. That's okay, you guys stay where you are, you know? And so you start to realize, the government appeases you in certain ways, and gives your community a little bit to sustain itself and say, you guys are doing well where you are, you don't need to reach out, you know? Mm-hmm. So you start to see things like that, you know, that's very kind of like, microaggression, or not microaggression, that's not the right term, but it's just confusing, you know, it confuses the community in terms of like, you're good where you are, we'll support you where you are, you know? And you're the model minority anyway, you know? Everybody wants to be like you anyway, so don't worry, you know, you're doing fine. So right when I graduated from college, I realized that by that time, I wanted to be a musician, I wanted to be an actor, I wanted to do visual arts, and I was an activist. It's like, San Francisco just was a little too small for me. And so I moved to New York City to see like where the big kids played. You know, I wanted to see what the ocean was like, because I was just swimming in a pond. Mm-hmm. Not that I was a big deal in the pond at all. You know, I was just curious, you know, mm-hmm. just really curious about, you know, if I was to challenge myself on being educated, I need to get out of my comfort zone and be where there's way more information. And yeah, when I got to New York City, it was just, you know, I was overloaded by then. You know, there's a lot of European thought and influencing arts in New York City that wasn't regional like California. And, you know, Asia also, where California was Asian American, New York City was Asia. You know, you had Japanese artists, Chinese artists, Taiwanese artists, you know, Thai artists, Cambodian artists, and these people who were like part of the diaspora and not necessarily not Asian American like they were in California. California's Asian American identity was pretty solid, in a sense that we understand our shared history as oppressed Asians in America. That's our identity. And if you adopt that identity, you're politically aware. That label or understanding of the label did not exist in New York City. Asian Americans could be anything. And even in California, it could be anything. But in New York City, Asian Americans could be just, if you're living in Asia, in America and you're Asian, that made you Asian American. Whereas, you know, in my older definition, not unless you identify with the political movement, are you Asian American, mm-hmm. you know, but I understand that it's quite open, and I'm not the gatekeeper for that. So anybody who considers themselves Asian Americans are Asian Americans. And even those who don't consider themselves Asian Americans are Asian Americans, you know? So when I got to New York City, I just wanted to dance and do music. You know, I tried to get an artist loft going, and I was auditioning, you know, to be in bands, and I was auditioning to be in dance, and because I was, you know, really into modern dance and ballet at this time. And I realized, man, I just can't do it all and work and pay the rent. You know, like very quickly I realized everybody's working to pay the rent in New York City. So I was lucky that I saw an ad that was looking for, this was after 6 months of auditioning. I was like, man, I must really suck because I didn't get anything, you know? There was an ad in the Village Voice looking for Chinese American performers, you know, a plus if you speak Chinese, modern dance, theater, music, you know, come and audition. I went, wow, that's for me. If I don't get that, I must really suck, you know? And so I auditioned and I got a part. And not only did I get a part, I got a big part, you know? They wanted me to read, they wanted me to act. And I was like, you know, I haven't really acted professionally. I spoke on stage in California, but I wouldn't call that like professional acting. And, you know, of course I didn't tell them that, you know, they just, hey, they cast me, I'm going to do it. You know, I better learn how to act quickly. So anyway, as we rehearsed, you know, I'm reading the script and, you know, and the director was like, oh, wait, are you an actor? I went, well, you know, I took performance art, I did some acting. They went like, oh, okay, I get it. All right, you got here on your raw talent. I get it. You're not really formally trained, you know, let's see what we can do with that. So luckily for him, Joel Basson, that he knew how to work with me to get, you know, natural me out. And so that was my first speaking professional role in New York City in Atlanta. And it opened 1 year the day I moved to New York, which was amazing. So by the, you know, so it took me a year. I opened a show in downtown New York. I was like one of the leads. And then people saw me in it. You know, other theater companies like Pan Asian Rep, Ping Chong. I was lucky. The Fred Ho, I mean, it was amazing. Fred Ho, the composer I mentioned earlier, composed the score for this production. So I met Fred and said, oh my God, I heard your production, Not a Chinaman's Chance. It changed my life. And actually I'm here and I'm working with you. It's amazing. And he's like, don't worry about it. You know, we'll do a lot of work together, you know? And it was, he took me under his wings. So Fred put me in his other operas and his other plays, and he took me on tour and he mentored me in terms of like what it takes to be an artist. It's a lot of hard work, you know? You have to be so dedicated to your intention, is your, you know, to what are you saying? You know, make sure you're clear in what you're saying with your art. You know, because you're gonna spend all this time stressing and you're gonna get attacked about your art. You better make sure you believe in your art, because people are gonna rip you apart, you know? And I learned a lot from watching Fred and Pan Asian Rep and Ping Chong. I was like, yeah, there are very critical reviews coming out in the New York Times, you know, about your work. And if you aren't really solid about what you're doing and saying, you know, it can end you, you know, it can make or break you. So I would say that Tisa Chang, was the second production I got. And that historical, you know, theater company, the oldest Asian American theater company in New York City, I was again fortunate. And you know, when earlier you asked if I was lucky or you know, to get into these roles, I think luck has a part of it, but also the other part of it is preparation and perseverance and determination. So I knew that I was gonna give it all I got in New York City. I didn't know how long I was gonna stay. That was 30 years ago, I'm still here. So it was like, I didn't know. I just had to give it all I got. And I was like, oh wow, Tisa Chang from Pan Asian Rep invited me to audition for her next show right after that. That means that's big. I read about them in my history class, that's big. And so, you know, I went from working with Fred Ho to Tisa Chang and then Ping Chong, you know, who comes from a very experimental background, who was a collaborator with Meredith Monk, and five years ago, received the Purple Medal of Honor from President Obama, you know, for being this amazing cultural artifact, you know, not artifact, artist for America. So his was the third production I worked with. And I thought I was extremely lucky. I thought I was extremely lucky to have put myself right there to be seen, then to have people invite me into the work. But then I hear about people afterwards now in hindsight when they say, oh, when we saw you, you stuck out, you know? And so I said, oh, okay. So it's not just luck, it's preparation and work. You really have to put yourself on the front line and say, I'm the one you want. I'm the one that's gonna make this play, you know? I don't know if that was really, I even really had that much experience, but it was more like just, you know, ignorance and probably like tenacity. You know, like I just came from San Francisco. I'm gonna make it or break it, you know? So it was probably that tenacity that got me in the door more than talent. I would say definitely more than talent, because I learned along the way that I knew very little compared to other people. And that, so as I learned how to act, as I learned how to dance and do performance art, I saw that, wow, this is a constant learning experience in life, because just because I graduated from college doesn't mean I know anything at all. It's just the beginning. It's like the Japanese, when you get your black belt, it's just the beginning of your study. And then you have 10 years and 10 other levels of black belt. So I would say that even now, as I got into my foot into the theater and I started learning more, you know, I learned, you know, quickly that I don't have that many skills. There's a lot to learn, because there are different styles of theater. different styles of film, different styles of acting. So what is it you want to do? You know, I'm never going to be a Shakespearean actor because that's not what I want to do. I don't want to be trained that way either. Those are not the stories I want to tell. I mean, I learned that pretty quickly earlier on. You know, it's like, oh, yeah, that's not for me. I'm not going to print, you know. But I do want to know, still want to know what Kelvin Han Yi and Sap Shimono was on in that play. You know, what they were doing, Philip Congatown on the stage. And then when I saw, you know, like Joy Luck Club came after I moved to New York, and I said, I want to know what Wayne Wong is doing. I want to know what those actors are doing. What is Russell Wong doing, you know? What is Dennis Dunn doing in the Big Trouble in Little China? You know, like he made this super amazing film, you know, and he was a great character, great actor. It's like I didn't have that kind of training, you know, like, and I couldn't bring the stage experience to that, a very different technique. But eventually I learned and I got into, you know, I had kids, I dropped out of acting to raise the kids at home. And then when they were a little old enough and I wanted to come back into acting, now it's my time to pursue film and television, because if I'm gonna go back to the stage or do acting, I need to bring in some income, you know, because I have to, like, I have a family now. And so I pursued film and television and learned the craft of that and started auditioning for that. And maybe it was luck, but I got hired on jobs, you know, and once people saw me and I got hired on other jobs. And I think I was just, you know, yeah, it, I would say, you know, just to make this segment, which could be a book, is a lot of it is about timing, luck, but you have to be ready when that timing and luck strikes.
Yeah, exactly. So kind of as an actor or as an Asian American actor, I feel like there's a lot of stereotypical roles that are typically cast in like TV and movies and films. And you're often cast as like a bad Asian father. Like, could you kind of share some of your thoughts about playing such a character and like how do you feel it kind of plays into stereotypes and maybe the activism in you? How do you feel about kind of those characters and stereotypes?
Right. So, you know, when I was trying to get into theater and even earlier on, I heard a talk. After a film screening, I think it's San Francisco Film Festival, and Kelvin Han Yi was one of the speakers, and Dennis Dunn, I think, was one of the speakers. And a lot of people from the Asian American Theater Company were speaking about those things, you know, like what happens when you get, as an Asian American actor, what happens when you get a stereotypical role? What do you do with it? Do you do the job? Because it's so important for us to get a job. Mm-hmm. If you don't get the job, you can't move on, you know? And if you get a job that's stereotypical, what do you do with it? And at the time, one of the actors, I wish I could remember who, said, well, it's our job to make those characters better. So if you take the job, then you have to make that character better and you have to fight in the room. And, you know, I remember that, that stayed with me because it's not easy to fight in the room when there's money. Those people have money and they're the ones giving you the job. It's like fighting your employer to hire you, you know, like, mm-hmm. No, we just need you to wash the dishes. It's like, no, but I need this kind of scrubber. I need this bleach. They're like, no, there's a lot of people that's going to do the job without all the things you need, you know, and they're not going to hire you, you know? So it's like figuring out how, once your foot is in the door, how do you talk to these people? How do you get them on your side? How do you say that role actually will be better for your story? If you played it out this way, you know, it'll be funnier for us and them if you played it out this way, as opposed to just funny on us, you know, so that we're not the joke. But, you know, like Big Trouble in Little China, for example, some people can say that film has stereotypes. Other people who see beyond the tropes go, man, they just ripped apart those stereotypes because now I see the actor. I see the character, I see the stories. I see the humanity in that actor, you know? Because somehow that film did it right, you know, with the white director. And they made the lead, Kirk, no, what is his name? His name escapes my mind. They made him the butt of all the jokes. Mm-hmm. And that made the Asians more intelligent. And the one, you know, and so that worked. And we realized, wow, that's a really good film. And it still, you know, still stands up to the test of times in terms of how they sort of flipped the stereotypes and the narratives, with the trope. And so what you just said about how does it feel to play like a stereotype of a bad dad, I would say that, is it a stereotype, you know, that I'm playing, or is it a trope that I take apart, you know, because it's a stereotype if it stays in one place, right? Yeah. That only serves one storyline, and that serves the storyline of the narrator. But some bad father, like in Warrior, is fighting white supremacy, killing white people. Mm-hmm. What does that say about the stereotype? You know, a lot of people, I agree, sees the trope and they can't see farther than that. So others go, oh my God, you know, you're such a badass and you just changed. I had, you know, the best compliment was that I had Chinese guys and non-Chinese guys come up to me and says, watching you talk to your son, Young Jun, is like watching my father talk to me. I've never had that on TV. So I would say that, yes, I took a trope, and I would say that also the credit goes to the writers, because the writers didn't write a trope, write a stereotype. They used a trope, but we used that trope to dismantle a stereotype, because at the end, that trope is much bigger. I mean, the character of Father June, if we're talking about Warrior, is much bigger than what the stereotype or trope was. And we deconstructed it, you know, and theoretically. So we could say, see that? We took it apart, but we got you. You know, we got you and we hooked you. And if we're to address that continuing on into another father, you know, which Boogie, it's, you know, you can ask whether Eddie Huang wrote a stereotype, you know, or not. I would say he didn't, because he based it on his father, and his father was a badass. His father, you know, his complaint about, you know, I'm not going to say anything bad about, you know, Fresh Off the Boat or any of the actors, but Eddie's complaint was that they made his family like a joke, a comedy, you know, so he didn't want his father. His father was not that. His father was not a clown, you know, his father was tough, you know, so like, this is our chance to show a tough Asian dad, you know. So if that fit into what people think of as a stereotype, I would say that you guys missed the point of the whole film. You know, the film is not told by white people using an Asian family and stereotypes. This is a, you know, a Taiwanese story whose writer had a badass dad. So I guess, you know, if you're talking about those two films, I would say that, you know, they can, while some may see a stereotype, it can exist in a different universe. For example, there's a lot of bad dads in movies in China and Hong Kong and Taiwan. You know, and you can't say those are stereotypes, because they just are those roles and those are those people. And the stories are quite dimensional. There's an arc, there's a catharsis, there's a movement of emotions. They went from one place to another in the story, narratively and emotionally. So stereotypes sit flat. So, So I don't know if I clarified that comment, but I play fathers and badass fathers and other things because I can't play a would-be father, you know, because I can't play the joke father, the father that people are going to laugh at. Mm-hmm. And it's because growing up and seeing those stereotypes and seeing the emasculated Chinese man in Hollywood, you're either, you know, and that's true of every ethnic stereotyping from Hollywood, is that you're going to have the villain and you're going to have the servant. Mm-hmm. So you have the, in African-American Black culture, you have the Sambo, Step and Fetch It, the butler, or you have the slave, escaped slave, you know, that's threatening to white women. And same with Latino culture, you know, the indigenous people, you know, they have Geronimo, you know, or they have the Tonto, you know, who serves the Lone Ranger. In Chinese culture, you have Fu Manchu, or you have Hop Sing, who serves the Cartwrights, you know, the white family. So what that's telling people of color is that, do you as an ethnic person want to be seen as a bad guy in our culture, or would you serve us, you know, as a servant? And that's something that's Hollywood representation does, shapes our sensibilities and our ideas and our ideas of who we are without us knowing, you know. And that's the power of Hollywood and the insidiousness of Hollywood. And so if I was to fall into one of the two, I do not want to perpetuate the weaker Chinese emasculated stereotype. And I'm going to be the one that's going to be threatening, mm-hmm. you know, at least that one is empowered.
Yeah.
You know, I would rather the Asian stereotype, if I was going to be stuck in a stereotype, it would be the empowered one. But when I look at these roles, I see them not as stereotypes. I see them as just tropes that are still trying to figure out how to change, because these writers today are writing much better than before. So it would be the actor's inability to get out of the stereotype these days more than it is the writers, I think. Because I think the writers have given us a lot more room, although they still are tight. I think that the actors really have to like see it as an opportunity to break out of these stereotypes and go, oh, I see you wrote it kind of like a trope and stereotype, because that's just the ghost of Hollywood, but it's like this, isn't it? It's more mm-hmm. like this. And I had to do that in several shows, and the directors were, oh, yeah. You know, and they realized, oh, if we shot it the way it's written, it could be kind of bad on us. Mm-hmm. We could look bad. We don't want to look bad, right? The director doesn't want to look bad. The director didn't write it. But you're talking to the director on the set, and he's the one directing you, you know? So it's we have agency. Actors have agency. It's our face up there. We have power. And I think that it's up to us to understand and not be afraid to use it.
Yeah, that's really inspiring. Before we move on to your career in music, I guess, would you mind if we take like a 2-minute break?
Not at all.
All right, just to get some water, and then we'll be right back. I'm gonna pause the recording. Yeah, I just kind of really wanted to appreciate the fact that you mentioned that there might be tropes that still exist about Asian Americans in acting and like in different characters, but kind of up to the actor or actress to kind of fight for a more diverse and more multi-layered dimensional character to empower more Asian Americans and to kind of fight against the stereotypes like you mentioned and to not just be a flat character. So yeah, really inspiring.
Thanks. Yeah, I mean, you know, we're just trailing Black Americans. You know, Black Americans dealt with this in the 60s and 70s, and they created their own, you know, industry. And, mm-hmm. you know, and they can because they have the numbers. So Asian Americans are quite small percentage-wise. But I don't think that we should be afraid of not selling tickets like Hollywood. I think our Asian American film festivals and our Asian American stars, AAPI stars on YouTube and TikTok are actually making a dent in mm-hmm. changing how we're viewed in society. And we should just do more of it, because, you know, I think, especially today, we're seeing how much Hollywood understands and hears us. We're no longer actually silent. And we've never been silent. We just weren't given the microphone, or we were muzzled, you know, mm-hmm. muffled and muzzled. So a lot of writers are seeing that they can't write like that anymore, you know, and some of those who aren't seeing it fully are on board as soon as you tell them.
Yeah, that's really good to hear. And I guess kind of moving on to your music career, you mentioned that when you were in Texas, you got into rock and roll and you kind of continued with music into college. But I know now you're interested in flute making, and I'm kind of curious, like, how did that kind of transition from rock and roll go into like kind of a traditional instrument?
Well, I was born and I was born or indoctrinated into Western popular music, you know, rock and roll, pop music, top 40 music as a kid. I remember the 70s soul groups on top 40. I mean, we're like some of the music I still love, you know? Mm-hmm. And it was easy to see the Black influence of popular culture, soul into rock and roll and blues, you know, from blues into rock and roll. And so a lot of my love of rock and roll was actually at the roots of rock and roll, which is Black music. Mm-hmm. I still love that. And when I started my theater group in New York City, I knew that I wanted to be exciting, like when you go to a rock concert, because there's, you know, rock concerts are so exciting, you know, music concerts. And so I you know, the members that I chose had to be able to play music live. And so we were like a garage rock band theater company, you know, the three mm-hmm. of us. We play music and do, you know, scenes. And it was the funnest thing ever, you know. And so in that theater world, I realized that as we're telling our stories, I was also in the process of being decolonizing myself, right? After the activism, SF State, moving to New York, and not wanting to do plays like Shakespeare, it's like, how do we tell our stories? And so my theater group was called SLAN, Three Asian American Men, telling our stories that nobody else would tell, you know? Only we could tell our stories. So we wrote the songs, we wrote our stories. And after we were writing, it was like, we also need to define our music in a certain way. So it's not white music or black music. You know, what is this music since we're called Slant? You know, what is this music? And so we decided our first show, we did a song called Buddha Blues. And it's like, you know, it's gotta have a bamboo flute in it, right? Mm-hmm. It's just gotta, you know, that's Asia right there, bamboo flute. And then what else does it have? You know, well, it's got to feel organic and roots and bluesy, like the blues, you know, but it's got this bamboo flute. And so we just started, you know, improvising on stage, not on stage, but for the rehearsals. And then, you know, we're talking and I said to the singer who's, you know, Rick Ebihara, who's fifth generation Japanese American, great, great singer, who is our lead singer of the band. I said, you know, can you improvise something like, you know, what I heard when I was a kid, my dad's Peking opera, Cantonese opera in the household with Elvis, you know? And it was like, whoa, you know? So with the bamboo flute and some guitar and drumming, he would just do these, you know, operatic voices, you know? It was so beautiful. And we're like, whoa, we're onto something, you know? So it's like a process. It's a process of discovering what the three of us could do and dig into our DNA, you know? And to both intellectually and physically, it's like, what's in there that we can make and authentically, not just theoretically, but in our bodies. And so Rick's voice was just influencing the sound of the bamboo flute, and we'd have these interweaving melodies. And then we interwove it with the song, you know, the lyrics from Elvis, you know, Heartbreak Hotel. And it was such a unique thing that we loved it. It was like Heartbreak Hotel meets Cantonese opera, you know, with bamboo flutes. And so it was in that production in that piece called Buddha Blues that I discovered a love for the bamboo flute. And it was a Chinese side blown at the time, Dizi. Mm-hmm. And then from that, I started exploring more bamboo flutes. And then in a show I was performing with La Mama that was not associated with SLANT, but supported by La Mama, the mother theater company of mm-hmm. SLANT. One of the pit musicians in a show I was cast in, experimental opera called Oedipus the King, there was a Japanese musician, Yukio Tsuji, playing the shakuhachi, the Japanese flute. And when I heard that, I was like, oh my God, that flute is so incredibly expressive, you know, and different, right? And it turns out that Yukio, you know, he has this Japanese soul that goes, you know, I just heard something from 2000 years, you know, ago when he played that flute. I was like, that's what I want right there. And then he showed me the flute and it was just like, I couldn't afford it, you know? And he says, well, even if you could afford it, you wouldn't be able to find a good one because you had to go to Japan. And this was pre-internet, this was 1993, you know? I mean, there was no way I was gonna find the shakuhachi. Anyway, so long story short, I learned how to make them. I copied mm-hmm. Yukio's flutes. I studied music with them, learned how to play it, how to make the sound early, and studied some of the early Zen instruments or Zen music. And I found a teacher in New York that taught the Zen music. Eventually went to Japan to study with a Japanese teacher and then came back. And that's when my children were born, coming back from Japan. I was like, okay, now we have to change our trajectory. You know, it's like, I can't play around on stage anymore. I have to start bringing in some income and insurance, you know? And then I was lucky at that time that the internet was born and that the shakuhachi was still an unknown instrument. And I built a website to make and sell shakuhachi, and I became popular, and it was just enough to support my family. And so I spent 10 years making, repairing shakuhachi from shakuhachi players all over the world, continuing to study with a great American teacher named Ralph Samuelson, one of the first American teachers who went to Japan to study shakuhachi. So I learned a very special lineage of the Kinkel Ryu, very special, sublime, deep music. And I still study with Ralph, and also my teacher in Japan, Kinya Sogawa, and then continue to work with professional players worldwide who come to me because I speak English. You know, like, you know, they don't speak Japanese, so they can't really get an instrument made, or they're a shakuhachi outside of Japan and they can't get it repaired because they can't, you know, translate. You know, well, you can, but you know, it's just difficult.
Mm-hmm.
But they come to me. And so I found a second career, and that allowed me to stay at home to raise the kids, be at the stay-at-home dad, and also stay involved with making shakuhachi and being an activist with shakuhachi too. So it all, you know, again, I was, maybe that was luck, or maybe I was at the right place at the right time.
Yeah, definitely. It's such an interesting kind of niche instrument, kind of a niche career that has like a large influence all over the world. And I was kind of wondering what goes into the process of like making a flute. How long does it take you? Do you need like special materials and tools? Like, could you kind of describe the process? Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. So there are two main kinds of instruments. So one is called the ji nashi. Ji is a plaster. Nashi in Japanese is without. So the ji nashi means a very simple bamboo without the plaster inside to tune. So those are, you know, all that requires is a saw, a measuring tool, and a drill. You know, then you can actually make the flute quite well. The other one is extremely complex, complicated, nuanced, and it's guided by your understanding of music, playing, and the different styles of playing and how people play differently so that you can get different sounds, and you want instruments to react to different styles. And that's similar for any instrument, whether it's guitar, violin, you know, a cello, or, you know, band instruments. You want an instrument that's good for the style of music you play. So if you're making a ji-ari, the other style in Japanese is translated as there is ji, there is plaster. Those contemporary instruments are very, very complex, time consuming, and it's difficult to get a good one. And so when we go back to my friend Yukio, who started, said it's difficult to get a good one. Mm-hmm. It's still true today. The difficulty is in being able to assess it, because you can have two, you know, or three non-working instruments in front of you. One of them will be great, but to a beginner, they're all the same. You know, you can't make a sound, they're all the same. Mm-hmm. But a good person will try all the different fingerings. There's esoteric fingerings, elegant fingerings, cross fingerings, different blowing techniques, different tunings, sound qualities, dynamic range. There's all these things that are going to judge an instrument that you won't be able to do unless you have a certain amount of playing in, you know, years, or you have a good teacher you trust. Mm-hmm. That can help you choose an instrument that you can grow with. So the simple ones I teach in Zen monasteries and private workshops around the country, because anybody who can, you know, measure, drill holes and cut with a very simple saw can make a flute. And so I've been able to do workshops with, you know, 10, 20 participants. And I think it's one of the best ways to share the shakuhachi, is the natural way, the very organic beginning way. And then when you get serious and you become a musician, you can get a bit more involved into the ji-ari, you know, contemporary instrument. And again, that one requires a lot more fabricating skills, measuring skills, different uses of paints, tools. Yeah, very, very complex.
Wow. Yeah, that sounds really so much more involved than, I guess, a regular, like, metallic band flute.
Yeah. Well, the metallic band flute is machined, right? So once mm-hmm. the person designed the machine, they're all going to be very different. The bamboo shakuhachi, what makes it unique and special is it's handmade. Yeah. And if you study with the right lineage, and in the olden days, shakuhachi was not an instrument that could be sold or purchased. You had to get it from your teacher. And the teachers were amazing players because that's all they did was teach and make flutes. So anybody with a flute back then played a flute that their teacher made. And, you know, in Japan, you would play like your teacher, you would eventually sound like your teacher. And that's a very unique experience. You know, if you go back to educating yourself in terms of what you want to do out of different systems, playing the silver flute and playing the shakuhachi are two very different activities, you know, ideologically and physically, you know, mm-hmm. and with the intention. You know, the shakuhachi came from just meditation and empathy and compassion for the world. And you're just chanting a sound, breathing, you know, deeply. The silver flute, you have to match yourself with other musicians to play a piece of music written by somebody who was composed it and somebody's orchestra's directing it, and then there's monies involved and unions involved. And, you know, it's a very different, two different worlds. And it's like, yeah, you could say there's the same in some ways because it's both a similar wind instrument, but the approach and system that they're in is totally radically different.
Yeah. You mentioned that you teach in Zen temples about how to make flutes and how to play the instrument. Would you describe yourself as a spiritual person? Or do you think that there's just a connection between the flute and Zen and nature that is just inherent with becoming a master of the instrument?
Yeah, I think both those things are true, what you just said. I think that I'm very spiritual, but not in, aligned with any particular doctrine of spirituality. Mm-hmm. I would say that I was introduced to Christianity as a child, have a Confucianist, Buddhist, Taoist upbringing through my parents. I explored Taoism in college, explored Buddhism, still do, and a mixture of Taoism and Buddhism, and other ways of thinking, and more contemporary philosophies that are rooted in spirituality and understanding the human experience in its most organic way. So I think that's the kind of a spirituality that I have. But I also think that the shakuhachi in its breathing is aligned with like all the traditional yogic and meditation practices that discovered deep breathing as a way to find and connect with certain parts of yourself that is that can open yourself and make yourself available to the world. I think that the yogic and Zen masters discovered that, and Buddhist teachers discovered meditation, deep breathing, thousands of years ago, and it's that is available in shakuhachi, and those who practice shakuhachi for the sound, just to play it and chill without wanting to become like a Zen master, will reap those rewards without trying to. And mm-hmm. I think that's what happened to me. After a year of playing shakuhachi for the music, I realized I was a much happier and chill person, and I was happy and chill before I played. So it was like, whoa, what happened, And it was really, it just came down to all the oxygen you give your brain to expand your brain and to relax the nervous system and just to open yourself up and all these other neural pathways that being open, being an open visual that lives in the present moment, all the joy and stuff that you can find by living in the present moment, really, I think cultivates a kind of spiritual intelligence without knowing it. So without that as your goal, it will just happen.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I feel like sometimes certain instruments and certain types of music really can bring out like a more spiritual and kind of a new depth to the human experience, really.
Definitely. Music will definitely do that.
And I guess kind of moving on to your role in activism, you mentioned a lot already in terms of your acting career, your theater career, and your constant pursuit to empower the AAPI community. I was wondering kind of with the past 2 years and the way that the pandemic has progressed, the way the politics has progressed in the country, like, could you kind of like tell me a little bit how you think that the AAPI community can work to fight AAPI hate and just anti-Asian sentiments in the country?
Right. So that's really a great question, and that's what a lot of people are grappling with, right? Everybody, especially AAPI, because more of the younger woke people are saying that, how do I talk to my parents? How do I talk to my siblings who are, kind of right-leaning, and not understanding what BLM is and sees the Black community as the ones that are attacking Asians right now, right? So, we don't really know what the numbers are. We know what we see on TV. We see Black people attacking Asians on TV and video. And part of the reason is because, we have those videos because those video recordings are more likely to be used in lower income areas in front of bodegas in New York City, garages in bad neighborhoods. And so when you have these two impoverished neighborhoods next to each other, who have been historically given crumbs, you know, like in cage together, given crumbs, we're gonna fight for the scraps. And I would say that a lot of these crimes are more crimes of opportunity more than crimes of racism. You know, when you see Black people attacking Asians, it's like, yeah, you know, like I'm not saying that Black, you know, nobody gets off the hook here. You know, we should all realize that committing crimes it's just the dark side of humanity. But if you're impoverished, coming from generations of abuse and oppression, you might not have another way to go, you know? And I'm not like making this, I'm not trying to say that Black people should not be held unaccountable for the attacks. I'm trying to say that the reason I see Black people attacking Asians is because there's a certain kind of trauma that is worked out more because the oppression and violence against Black people have been so much greater and longer in American history than it has been against Asian Americans or Asians API, because we only started immigrating to this country in the early 1800s, more around the 1850s. And then by that time, African Americans had already been enslaved and lynched for over 200 years. You know, they've already been suffering for generations of that sort of oppressive, violent trauma. So what do they do with that? You know, they can only sing so many gospels, you know, and eventually it's going to erupt in different ways. You know, like eventually they're going to realize Jesus is not going to help us out of this, you know. Mm-hmm. And so now when they're put together next to a Asian community that was brought in at the very end of the Emancipation Proclamation, let's bring in cheap Asian labor. Let's make them the new slaves. You know, because that 1% that was controlling the economy, that was controlling the building of the labor railroads, that, you know, screw the North. You know, we lost our slaves and we're not gonna hire Black people. Let's get indentured servants over here. Let's get those cheap Asian laborers over here. You know, we're gonna tell them that they can pay off their debt. You know, they're all poor, illiterate laborers who can't read. Let's just have them sign the contract and say, you'll pay this off in a year. Little did those indentured servants know that they weren't going to pay those contracts off for many, many, many years, and many died before they did, right? Building the railroads with bombs and stuff like that. So if we don't recognize that kind of, machinations from white supremacy and capitalism, then we can't really address these violences today. When you look and see that, you know, and Warrior spelled it out quite well on the first episode, episode one, season one, scene one, when Assam gets off the boat, the lead character, and sees signs, these white people saying, Chinese, go home, chant it. They spit on them, right? Mm-hmm. Like, that's what they came into. That's how the Chinese in America started. And that's because the political demagogues said, okay, now here we have more people taking your jobs. It's not only the Blacks, but it's these Asians taking your jobs, and you know what, hire me, I'll take care of it, right? That's what these people were saying, the capitalists. And you know, it's so insidious because it's like they're pitting their own people, you know, the white, the Irish against the Chinese, but at the same time, and it's all spelled out in Warrior, it's like, but we're gonna use them to a certain point and then we'll give you the jobs. You know, it's all these under backroom dealings, you know, how people of color are manipulated and our lives are on the line. And you saw how, in one episode, I don't know if you saw it, but, what is that called? I don't want to give too much away, spoiler, but we see a lynching, Chinese lynching in Warrior. And that story is not told often, but when Chinese was first coming, there were a lot of lynchings, just as many as, ex-African slaves being lynched, Black slaves being lynched, and Chinese were lynched. Our numbers were so much smaller, but there were just as many lynchings. So it made the lynchings of Chinese proportionally even greater, but it's not reported in mass media. So when you have that kind of history, you know, and then you see how they can use the numbers, the small numbers of Chinese at that time, which was 1 or 2% of America, and you have African ex-slaves at 20 or 30%, you know, you could see how they would, like, they can say, let's give a little bit more to the Asians to appease them and divide and conquer, you know, so that they can't all ask for affirmative action if Asians are doing better. you know, like, look, just do a little better. Look at the Asians, they're doing a little better, and they're not asking for, you know, equal opportunity jobs and all that stuff. You know, they're getting up there through education. Why don't you guys do the same? You know, why don't you guys become the model minority? So you see how insidious that stereotype is also, and how at the end it's all used to manipulate and oppress us. And, you know, getting back to what we can do about it is to get educated. Mm-hmm. You know, if you see, you know, and also we don't really know if the Black people in numbers are greater. We see that in video. There are reports and studies, one coming out of the University of Michigan, saying there are more violent incidences towards Asians from white people by far than Black people. We just don't have those on video to show you, mm-hmm. you know, because they could be happening in suburbs. You know, and I have friends who were attacked by white people. People I know were attacked, you know, Asians were attacked by white people. It's not on video, yeah. you know? And they're in the suburbs with, you know, and in the suburbs, you don't see cameras around catching this stuff. So we have to question where the videos come from. Why aren't there more videos? And what are the real numbers? Because if they're not being reported, we don't know what the real numbers are. And we do know historically that the media has always wanted to and purposefully portray Blacks as the violent criminals. You know, there's way more news media on Black on Black crime, using the term Black on Black crime and Blacks as being violent and Blacks, more Blacks in jail than whites, to scare people, to say that Blacks are more violent, when in reality, white on white crime is much, much bigger. Way more white on white crime, but there's not a term, that's not floating around in our culture to say, what about white on white crime, you know? So we do know that the media is slanted, you know, pardon the pun, against Black people. And we see that happening now. And we have to understand that the reality is not what we think it is. No matter what, it's gonna be a different reality because we don't know what the numbers are. And we also don't know, for example, a lot of the attacks from Black people on Asians in New York City were from the homeless that needed more mental support. Mm-hmm. That they were in homeless shelters, and we realized that, you know, they actually were people who needed mental support, you know, mental disabilities, and they would put it in with the homeless, and now they're wandering the streets and they attack people. And so it's not a racist thing, but it's an issue of just, like, you know, mental health. So, you know, we can look at, you know, class, mental health, impoverished neighborhoods, manufactured poverty, putting two, you know, ghettos next to each other, crimes of opportunity. There's so much more, such a bigger picture than to say, look at the Black people attacking Asians now. You know, that's a very simple way to look at it. And if you can tell people that, hey, you know, there's a lot more information out there that's not given us, that's gonna take a lot of effort actually to learn, and that no one is gonna tell you this because, you know, the structured racism in this country wants you to be ignorant.
Yeah.
And wants you to continuously see Black people as a problem.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. There's a lot of like bias in the media against Black people in America, and with the rise of AAPI hate, but there's also a lot of solidarity between like Black activists and Asian American activists in different rallies and support organizations. So I feel like there's definitely not an equal representation of what
if anything, that's a silver lining right now. So just to sort of follow up on your question, it's like, so the great thing now is that we see a galvanizing of Asian American community, youths and older people, and across all aspects of society, from students to workers to actors and activists and musicians and corporations, coming together to form organizations that are going to educate against this. So that's the silver lining around this. And I think that, you know, I also used to say that the Black people were so tight because of the oppression was so great. And now the oppression is actually quite great on AAPI, you know, communities. And that's why now our galvanizing and coming together is actually so great. And I'm excited to see like the Asian American Foundation formed. It's called TAF, T-A-A-F. And, you know, they raised $1 billion in like less than 2 weeks. And that shows the power the Asian, you know, American Pacific Islander Native Hawaiian community now is that we have money, you know, in our organization. We have people. Mm-hmm. If we band together, there's a good, you know, there's going to be a good voting percentage that we can actually get people out. So, and I'm excited to see that today. And I think it's a second wave from what happened with Vincent Chin, you know, in the 80s. Mm-hmm. So it's heartening.
Yeah, definitely. And then you kind of mentioned this briefly, but how do you think art, media, and performance can affect the social climate in the United States?
Well, you know, everyone knows the AAPI communities were faced with a double pandemic, right? We had mm-hmm. the coronavirus to deal with, and we had hate and violence to deal with. So with the coronavirus, you know, you could see that the government and everybody coming together, asking everybody to mask up, get vaccinated, you know, like, this is common sense, people, let's do it. Of course you had people not doing it, you know, and they're the problem, right? They're mm-hmm. the anti-maskers are the problem. They are the problem.
You yes. know?
They are the red states that, you know, believes in conspiracy theories and attacked our capital. You know, they are the problem. So with the pandemic, we also need our communities to come together in the same way. We need those civic leaders. We need the teachers. We need our coworkers. We need our family to fight racism in the same way and to point to hate as a virus. And where does it stem from? You know, it stems from a structural, systemic white supremacy embedded into our constitution and our voting systems. You know, if you look at what's happening in Georgia and across, you know, Texas and Arizona mm-hmm. and the new Jim Crow laws and voter suppression, it's like it's happening right now in front of you. And you always, people have asked, how did this happen back then? Where were we? You know, it's happening now. And what are you doing now? You know, so, how artists and musicians can help is that we are the voice of the people, you know? We are the soul of the people. I mean, we do need everybody. We need the people who pay money to buy a ticket to see a show, whether it's a movie or a theater show or a concert. You need to spend that money on somebody on the right side of this effort. Do not spend your money watching a film that's made on the wrong side. Mm-hmm. of this fight, because it is a fight, right? It's a good versus evil here, you know, and we're fighting people who are attacking us. So spend your money on Asian American film festivals if you want to see films. Plenty of great stories out there, right? Minari, you know, The Farewell, you know, all of these things are empowering the storytellers who are giving the AAPI community's voice, who is allowing our soul to be seen and felt in society for other people who don't know AAPIs, people to say, oh, actually, I can relate to them. You know, Minari is just like my family. Mm-hmm. You know, whether you're Black or white, Minari is like, it happened to us. You know, I know who they are. Oh my God, you know, again, it's like if we're only 6% of the population now with half of it being immigrant, like how is anyone gonna know who we are unless you work with us? You know, and unless you watch a TV show about us, unless you see Boogie, Warrior, FOB, you know, Fresh Off the Boat, or some of these other movies out there now that really is telling authentically our story, not a story made up by a white person to tell their story where we serve, you know, their agenda, but our voices being centered. You know, so spend your money or on shows that's centering our authentic voice, and that will help. You know, I was around when Bruce Lee changed my culture, when Bruce Lee changed our culture. I was around to experience getting picked on to being cool because of Bruce Lee. So that's the power of representation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I feel like it's definitely what you were saying in the beginning, like music and performers and artists are the soul of the people. I feel like that's very true and really works to help change the climate that we're currently living in.
Writers,
yeah, you
know, writers, designers, costumers, everybody who's working creatively to give a voice, you know, that can be sort of to give our community an authentic voice. I mean, it's chefs, chefs who are starting restaurants that are popular and that can actually speak, you know, of a certain culture. I mean, I think they're really powerful also.
Mm-hmm. And I guess kind of closing, like kind of questions about your identity and what you hope for the future. Like, how do you identify yourself? Just kind of generally, this refers to like do you consider yourself Chinese American, Asian American, API? Like, how do you identify yourself?
I identify myself as an American first and then as a citizen of the world. A lot of Chinese Americans say they don't belong either in America or when they go back to China, or when they go to China for the first time, like me, like I didn't belong there either, right? So you spend your whole life thinking I don't belong anywhere. But there's a certain moment when you realize you're woke. What does that mean? You're finally born. Born of what, And then I could say I was born not in 1964, but I was born the moment I became consciousness of all the ancestors who I stand on to share their voices to make this a better world. And I'm talking about Martin Luther King and Malcolm X, and Frederick Douglass. They're my ancestors. So I was born from them. And who am I then? I would say I'm an American because they were Americans. But in terms of I'm sorry, what's the second part of your question?
Oh, it was just like a
Was
simple
that
like how do you identify yourself? What do you consider your
okay?
identity?
Then that's it.
Great. And then kind of what are your hopes for the AAPI community in the United States? Like, how do you hope to see us in the future?
My hopes for the AAPI Hawaiian Natives are that we should recognize that we have power in unity, and that any sort of division comes from structural racism. And we have a shared goal. We have a shared common goal to be free and to be free and to be recipients of what the Constitution in America offers everyone. Life, freedom to pursue life and liberty and happiness. We deserve that, and if we unify within ourselves, within I'm talking about because you're an American now. I'm not talking about if you're Taiwanese and Chinese, and you have your ties back then. You can't become solid here because of that. I would say that you're an American now. And that in America, we need to be together because we need to fight systemic white supremacy that's killing us. And so that we need to join in solidarity within ourselves first, and then with our brothers and sisters of Latinx and Black people. And know that the Black people are still suffering much greater oppression and violence today, even though we had a Black president, we have a Black entertainers that are superstars, and we have Black athletes to say, hey, look how good Black people are doing. You don't need equal housing or better education, So same thing with the model minority myth. It's all like a little tease to say that to appease you for the moment, but in reality, most of us are struggling. And in order for most of us to get out of the cages that we're put in, we need to stick together. And when we stick together and bond in solidarity, we're just going to rip open that cage and realize that that pie is available for everyone to share. We're not just getting crumbs. So solidarity, recognize our differences, celebrate our differences towards the common goal of freedom and love.
Definitely. I really hope that resonates and something that we can hope to achieve in the near future. And I guess the last question I have for you is like, would you like to leave a message, kind of like a time capsule for your future generation of Asian American actors, or just your possible grandchildren or great great grandchildren?
Being an activist is a lifelong struggle. Learn to love it.
It's amazing. Okay. Thank you so much for spending time with me today and answering all my questions. I really appreciated everything that you shared about your life story and how you first started your acting career and your music career and all that, and your dedication to activism, which I really feel that a lot of people can learn from.
Thank you, Sonia. It was a pleasure to be here, and thank you for providing this platform because, you know, like we said earlier, the representation works, but we also need people to help us be seen, and you're doing your job here. And thank you so much for that.
Thank you so much for spending time with the interview today, and Paul really appreciates it. I hope you have a good rest of your day, and stay out of the heat.
Thank you. You too.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.